Well, I'm Sylvia Law. I teach here. It's a great honor to welcome you all to the 19th annual Rose Sheinberg Lecture. I say it every year for 19 years, but it's amazing that this program has flourished and blossomed in the way that it has. We're grateful to Jill and Richard Sheinberg, sitting right up here in the front, who also represent Dale and Arthur Galston. And the Sheinbergs are relatives, family of Rose, who was a progressive woman, an educator, a graduate of this law school. Jane Dalkart is also in the front here and gave the program a little more money from the estate of her Uncle Joel. The Sheinbergs had the wisdom when they set up this program to create an unusual structure. The Sheinberg program is governed by a self-perpetuating committee dominated by students. There are a few faculty members, Holly McGuigan, whose husband Abdeen is in the back, but I think is not here with us. Elena Das, who's a clinical professor, and Katie Tinto, who's been on the committee for some years now and is going to abandon us to go across the square to Gartozo next year, but it's close enough that you'll have to come back. The third year students are Tava Schleffer and Elizabeth Jordan, who will leave us this year. The second year students are Altuza Emsali, Leah Kang, and Emily Kenny. All of you guys stand up so we can acknowledge you. It's really the students who pick the scholar, do the work that's involved in organizing a program like this, including the wonderful, wonderful lunch we had with a small group of students and Kathy and Chase earlier today. Also honored tonight to have, I think for the first time ever, a former Sheinberg scholar in residence, Professor Bernadine Dorn of Northwestern, right there. She was our second lecturer, and I'm also going to acknowledge two of the former lecturers of the other great lecture series at NYU Law School, and that's the Madison Lecture, and we have Pierre Laval of the Second Circuit, and Michael Boudin, who's also Kathy's brother. And my only job, apart from thanking all these wonderful people and welcoming you, is to introduce Chase. Chase is a graduate of the Yale Law School, now working as a public defender in San Francisco, integrating criminal defense and immigration work. Also the author of a fabulous book, a political analysis of Latin America from a progressive point of view, that I would praise most highly by saying it's written from a very humble perspective. And it's a great read. It's listed in the program. And with that, I give you Chase.
Thank you, Sylvia, and thanks to all of you for coming and inviting us here and joining us here today. I think probably everybody in the room has had the opportunity countless times in their life to introduce their mother. Few of us get to do it in front of such a large and distinguished audience. So I'm doubly pleased and honored to be able to do it today because I actually have two mothers in the room. One of them, Bernadine Dorn, gave the Sheinberg Lecture in 1994, and the other one, Kathy Boudin, will be giving the lecture just as soon as I finish up today. I think it's safe to say I'm the only person in history to have two mothers give a Sheinberg lecture. So let me take a quick step back and explain how it is that I came to have two mothers. I live in San Francisco, where two mothers is about as common as having a mother and a father. But my two mothers aren't what you might expect. In fact, my biological mother, Kathy Boudin, who's speaking today, was arrested and incarcerated when I was just 14 months old. And at that time, I was taken into another family and raised by Bernadine Dorn and Bill Ayers as part of their family, as one of their three sons. My two mothers cooperated really magically throughout my childhood and even into my adulthood. Bernadine was there every day, helping raise me. Kathy, from the time I was 14 months old onward, could not be there because she was incarcerated in a New York State maximum security prison. But she managed to invent parenting from a distance. Now, before I talk about Kathy as a mother, her CV, her resume, highlights of which are in the program, I'm sure, are truly inspiring. And her resume reflects a tireless commitment to working on behalf of those less fortunate than herself. She went to Bryn Mawr. She was a leader in the civil rights movement and the anti-war movement during the Vietnam War era. She became a member of the Weather Underground. She was arrested in 1981 after the tragic Brinks robbery went wrong. While she was incarcerated, she became the first woman in the history of the state of New York to earn her master's degree from behind prison bars. While in prison as well, she published a wide range of articles and books, including a widely cited article in the Harvard Educational Review. And she's been a leader in effective advocacy on a wide range of issues, from AIDS and healthcare to prison reform. And she'll talk to you about that. Mostly what I want to talk about today is something that I think I'm somewhat uniquely positioned to talk about as her only son, and that is the woman behind all of those accomplishments. When my mom was arrested, as many people do, she might easily have given up on the idea of being a mother at all. She might easily have felt sorry for herself, turned inwards, and given up on the possibility of having a relationship, of building a relationship with her son. But not my mom. That's not what she did. She invented, as I said earlier, she invented parenting from a distance. She wrote letters almost every day when I was a young child. And as I was struggling to learn to read, hard to read a letter if you don't know how to read at all, she came up with games and competitions of letter writing to make it fun and creative and exciting for me to engage in a back and forth through letters. She had the opportunity to call me on the phone with some frequency. But which 4-year-old or 7-year-old child wants to spend 20 minutes talking on the phone with their parent? None that I know. She figured out how to make it fun by telling stories one chapter at a time, adventure stories. Of course, I was the star. She still lets me tag along onto her coattails today. But she also would do things like record audio cassette tapes for me so that when I wasn't allowed to call her, and she could only call me during certain pre-approved times, if I needed to hear her voice, hear her reading a story, a book, a poem, or simply telling me how much she loved me, I could pop that cassette tape in and listen to it in my room with the door closed on repeat. When I was a child, I went through a multi-year phase of bad behavior, temper tantrums. I hear some people laughing who knew me as a child because they think I'm understating it. But the truth is it took an awful lot of love and support. And it was particularly difficult for my mom in prison to find a way to engage with me, to find a way to parent, even as I had those problems, particularly in the context of prison visiting room visits. I saw countless mothers in prison feel helpless and act helplessly in the face of problems their children were having in the visiting room, but not my mom. When I got into fights with other children in the visiting room, when I decided I wanted to pout and scowl and refuse to talk to anyone, she refused to give up. Didn't matter what it was, how old I was, she would come up with some ridiculous thing to do to make me laugh, to make me come out of my temper tantrum and take advantage of the few hours remaining before visiting hours were terminated. Someone with my mom's background could easily have turned inwards throughout her incarceration, could have refused to take note of or participate in the community that she was forcibly injected into. But not my mom. Instead, she threw herself into AIDS education, literacy work, bilingual literacy work, parenting classes, and much more. She embraced the women in her prison in a spirit of solidarity, not service. She was one of them, neither better nor worse. And as at every single other moment in her life that I'm aware of, she dived headfirst into the work of building community. When my mom got out of prison in 2003, at age 60, after 22 years of the daily stress of living on a cell block with 60 other women, she might easily have been ready to head straight for retirement. She might easily have been ready to take up golf. But not my mom. Instead of throwing in the towel, she threw herself into AIDS and other healthcare work at Roosevelt St. Luke's Hospital, into a doctoral program at Columbia University Teachers College, and into invaluable work on prison issues that I will let her describe to you. Most people as professionally successful and accomplished and overcommitted as my mom jettison those closest to them. Most people with the kinds of professional obligations my mom has neglect family, friends, lovers, children. There simply is not enough time in the day and something has to give. But not my mom. Whether nursing sick family or friends, whether pulling all-nighters in the hospital to take care of one of my distant cousins who had a leg injury, whether being there on the deathbed for friends of her parents, mentoring cousins, nephews, babysitting for my brother's children, her grandchildren, every single chance she gets, or answering the phone when I call, no matter what meeting she's in the middle of or what appointment she's late for. She manages to keep her eyes focused on the big picture policy issues and her feet firmly rooted in her community of friends and the people that matter most. I often ask myself, how is it possible to do so much and yet be so available and so supportive of the people around her? And there's a one-word answer: Mom.
Wow. I guess I really need to begin by just saying the best thing I ever did was to have my son. So I'm so honored to be here and excited to be able to share with you. I want to thank the Sheinberg Committee of Faculty and Students, of course, for giving me this opportunity and honor. I really want to thank my immediate family for coming from San Francisco, from Chicago, from Boston to be here today with me. My friends, so many of whom I was incarcerated with, are here and who I'm now able to do work with outside. Men who were incarcerated who are home now, who I didn't know before but I'm working with. So many friends that my parents knew, my father, my mother. You're here today, which makes a great difference because I feel like they're here, the intergenerational experience of being here. And of course, people whom I don't know. I'm happy that you're here and I'm happy to be able to share with you and to hear what you have to say after we speak. I want to also talk about the people that are still in prison and not here and remember them. People David Gilbert, Judy Clark, Sekou Adinga, Rosalind Smith, so many other people that aren't here, but I'm thinking of them. We want them here with us, and hopefully someday they will be. So thank you very much, and you know, the title of my talk today is Hope, Illusion, and the Imagination, the Politics of Parole and Reentry in the Era of Mass Incarceration. There is a traditional saying when you leave prison: leave your shoes, but don't look back. When I left prison after 22 years, I walked down the path. But how could I not look back? The hands of women were visibly waving, pressed up against the bars that were making lines on the window, the chicken wire that was creating little squares in that window. They were pressing their hands against it and waving goodbye. I had done this myself for many years. They watched, holding their breaths, as I walked into a little security kiosk and then walked in as a prisoner and came out 1 minute later as a free person. I turned around and waved to them. I left, and they stayed. A year later, I met with the head of a foundation, and I said to him, would you be willing to give a grant to support the investigation of the lives of people that are in prison, the long-termers, the people that are really the role models and the leaders for the other people that are there and are coming in? He was listening, and so I plunged on forward. I said, these are the people who have committed violent crimes. They're the people whose crimes led to deaths of other people. He looked at me and he shook his head. He said, Kathy, why do you have to ask about those people? Couldn't you think of somebody else? Couldn't you think of something easier? I took a deep breath and I said, you know, first of all, I'm one of those people. Secondly, these are the people with whom I worked. They're the people with whom I did my time. They're people who are struggling to get out, and yet they keep getting denied at the parole board. And yet they're the very people who have done enough time in prison to be able to make meaning out of their lives, to be able to have faced the things they did that harmed other people, and to have been able to change their lives. They're the people who give hope to the younger people that come in at the age of 19 and are looking at sentences of 20 years, longer than they've ever lived. And yet they can't get out because of parole policy. I said, you know, it's a critical lens into the criminal justice system. We're now able to talk about people in prison that were there for drug issues, for nonviolent crimes, and that's important too. But if we can deal with this issue, we're going to be looking at an issue that's going to open up the possibility of saying, what is our criminal justice for, system for? Is it solely for punishment? So he looked at me, and he shook his head, he scratched his head again, and then he said, well, all right, if you're willing to do it, not just interviews with people, but a recidivism study, the recidivism rate study, I'm open to doing this. A short time later, a group of us met at the CUNY Grad Center. Professor at the Grad Center, Professor at John Jay College, had agreed to take on this study. There were about 10 of us. We called ourselves the alumni. All of us were people that had done 15, 20, or 25 years in prison. Most of us had now master's degrees. Some had college degrees. And we wanted to do this because we knew about the people that we had left behind and how hard it had been to get out. And there were a few people there who hadn't done long sentences for serious crimes, but they'd been mentored by people who had the long sentences. We call them the long-termers. And so they were part of that project as well. And that's part of what I'm going to share with you today, is what we learned in that project. Parole denials are really part of a much larger system that's been created over the last 40 years at least, about punishment, a paradigm of punishment. And yet it's not only just punishment, it's actually more permanent punishment. If we look at punishment, we know that the numbers of people, many of you can probably say 2.3 million people in prison, you know? 1 out of 100 adults are incarcerated. 9 out of every African-American men between 18 and 34 are incarcerated. We know these statistics. But when I was at school of social work teaching a class in the last couple of weeks, I taught a class of 300 people divided into five sections. I asked every class, how many of you know somebody who was incarcerated? Almost every person out of 300 people raised their hand. That's mass incarceration. All right. But in addition to just punishment and incarceration, there's the issue also of permanent punishment. Permanent punishment we can see in a whole number of areas. There's the death sentence. There's the length of sentences. There's solitary confinement. There's civil commitment. There's juvenile justice. There's keeping aging people in prison. And then there's coming home and still being punished with a whole lot of legislation that we call collateral punishments. Why did I pick the issue of parole to talk about? I picked it because it was an issue that I understood well, that I had gone through, and it relates to so many people that I know that are ready to come home and can't get out. I picked it because I felt it was a core issue. If we could get under the stereotypes and the stigma that are attached to people who have committed violent crimes and be able to see the person underneath it and understand that holding them in prison has nothing to do with them being a public risk, nothing to do with whether they've transformed themselves, and nothing to do with the community that they can serve. If we can get under that and know that they're being kept in only for the purpose of punishment, then maybe we can look at the entire system and be able to change it. You know, it's interesting. I haven't done this much public speaking in this kind of a large setting, and I didn't quite get the relationship between the microphone and how I'm holding the papers, and I thought that I could sort of look at the papers as I spoke. So let me just find my paper here for a second. I want to tell a couple of short stories, all right? I met Sue when she first came into Bedford. She had been actually involved in a crime, but first her earlier life was one in which she had been terribly abused at home, ended up running away and getting into a group home. The group home itself had enormous issues, and she tried to figure out a way to get out of that when she was 15 or 16. She met a man who appeared to be somebody that she could actually be involved with, and who maybe would have connections that could get her into a larger, into a different life. It turned out that that gentleman was somebody who not only had a terrible criminal justice and mental health issue, had been involved in violent crimes, and ended up being really abusive to her as well. Perhaps there were moments when she could have left, but at that time, what she felt was that she was stuck, and she ended up herself participating in crimes with him that led her to 18 years to life sentence. When she came to Bedford, she joined the very first domestic violence support group, which became the beginnings of what ended up being public hearings held inside of a prison in 1985, where 11 women testified about the experience of violence that they had had in their lives and the relationship between that violence and the violence that they had committed. They didn't feel good about what they had done, even if you could justify it, even if you could rationalize it, but they wanted to understand it. And so Sue was part of that process, and when money was given after the hearings to build a family violence program at Bedford, she was one of the people that led that process and opened it up so that other women could also understand what had happened to their lives that had led them to be violent. She took her college degree, associate's and bachelor's degree, and then began to work with young people coming in. When she went to the parole board 18 years later, I think she assumed that given everything that she had done inside, the fact that the judge had given her a sentence of 18 years and not the maximum of 25, that she would probably go home. But instead the judge sentenced her. Instead the parole board said to come back in 2 years. And then they said to come back in 2 years again. And then they said to come back in 2 years again. Until she had done 10 extra years in prison. And they said on every parole denial, "You've done very well in prison. You've done excellently. We'll see you in 2 years." Then I met Samuel. Samuel had been home for 1 year. He was an elegant-looking older man who told me he had done 33 years in prison. I asked him, "Well, how many years was your sentence for?" He said, 15. I said, "You mean you've done a longer time in beyond your sentence?" And he said, "Yeah, I did 18 years more. I'm now 63. So I said, "Well, what happened? You know, what was your life?" And he said, "Well, I was involved in the juvenile justice system, and I did get into a brawl. I was involved in situations where violence took place, and I had a gun, and there was a brawl, and I clicked it, or they said that I had clicked it, and they said it was attempted murder, and I got a 15-year sentence. But it was the lowest that the judge could have given. He could have given 25. Well, when Samuel was arrested, he immediately got his GED, passed it at Rikers Island, and went on to prison, and he got a first year of a business associate's degree, and then he got a bachelor's degree from SUNY New Paltz, then he got a master's degree in sociology from Syracuse University, and then he got a master's degree from New York Theological, and he became one of the first people to begin an AIDS program that was going to be peer-based, with the idea that it would be people in prison that would educate each other and be able to handle the epidemic, which was out of control at that time in the end of the 1980s. And then he became a brilliant law clerk in the law library working on other people's cases. So when he went to the parole board after 15 years, I think he had an expectation that he would be coming home. The parole board denied him, and they denied him 10 times until he had done 18 years, almost 20 years in prison, extra than what he had been actually sentenced to with a minimum sentence. I think that these stories must raise the question about how does it happen that somebody does 10, 15, or 18 years more in prison when there's no indication that they might be a public risk? It's not even said on the parole denial that they're a public risk. And in fact, they've done an enormous amount to change themselves. You know, the way the system works is that if you have an indeterminate sentence, many acts of crime now no longer have an indeterminate sentence. But the indeterminate sentence, for people especially that have a life sentence at the end, means that the judge will give you a minimum and the maximum is life. And the parole board, and it varies from state to state how this happens, but parole has the opportunity to turn you down. The expectation has always been that when the judge gives you a sentence, they've assessed the nature of the crime and been able to figure out a punishment, and that the parole would really be evaluating sort of, are you ready to go home? But in most states, in this last period of this 40-year period we're talking about, it's been harder and harder for people to get home. Just a few examples. In the mid-1990s, the governor of Maryland announced that he was no longer give parole to anybody who had a life sentence on the back and had a violent crime. In California, you had 20 years of four governors that refused to let possibly only two or three people out of prison a year that had been involved in a violent crime in which someone had died. And in New York, under Governor Cuomo, Mario Cuomo, at least when people went to their first parole board, if they'd had a violent crime in which somebody died, 28% would go home after that first board. When Governor Pataki was elected, it went down to 3% and then 1%. So you can see that really parole, letting people out is actually a policy. There are choices to be made. And in this era, when so many people, when the tough on crime era has been here, that the mass incarceration phenomena that has put so many people in prison with nonviolent crimes, that the people that did have a violent crime could not get out. This really comes not just from the state governors, it also comes from the federal government, which in 1994 passed the Omnibus Crime Bill and paid states more money to build prisons if they would keep people in prison for a longer amount of time if they had a violent crime. You know, when you go to the parole board at the end of 15 years or 20 years, hope is palpable. You know, there's a transforming energy that takes place because suddenly you're free to imagine what it would be like to go home and be able to wear blue and black, which are clothing that you can't wear in prison because you can't wear it because it's the uniforms of the officers. So you imagine wearing blue jeans and wearing your black shirt, walking down the street and picking a restaurant to go to. And of course you imagine being hugged by your children and grandchildren now and possibly by your parents if they're still alive. You let your imagination go. And when you go down in that parole board, you have hopes that the people that look at you will see that you're not the same person that went in. Usually, at this point, you're not even going to be with people. You'll be talking to people through a video camera. And one of them may actually have their head down so that you don't even see their face because they're reading a file of the person that comes after you, which they haven't had time to read yet. Or maybe it's your file, your 20 years of a person in prison that they also haven't had time to read yet. And the lead questioner in the parole hearing will ask questions. Mainly they care about the crime and what you've done. And even if you've wanted to talk to them about who you are now, it's very difficult to get to that point. And it's difficult to feel that they care very much about that. And when you leave the hearing, you have no idea what happened. You wait for an envelope. And when you get that envelope, might be the next day, it might be a week later, you run your fingers across it. Because if it's thin, you know that you were granted parole. And if it's thick, you know that you were turned down. It has the appeal papers in it. It's very difficult, but you try to constrict your imagination again and come back to living in the more narrowed circumstances of prison. One of my colleagues that I've worked with since I've come home, he wrote a piece right after he was turned down after 20 years in prison. He wrote a piece in which he talked about answering the psychiatrist's question, the person that interviewed him before he went to the parole board, and he said, "Yes, when I think of my upcoming parole board appearance, I think about who I was and who I am. I would like to be seen in the present, not in the past. I don't want the 35-year-old to be judged again for what the 16-year-old did. I don't want the man to be punished for what the teenager did. They're two different people." And then he received the thin letter. Parole decision denied for 24 months. Based on the nature and circumstances of the instant offense involving and concerning a planned robbery of a victim wherein one of your co-defendants shot the victim, causing his death. You were convicted at trial. We note your academic accomplishments and program participation. He finally came home 5 years later, writing this piece that I just quoted from, helped him. He's a writer, he writes poetry. He's now a program director at Rikers Island for young people, hoping that they don't end up again in prison. Sue, who spent 10 extra years in prison, said, people have to turn into themselves and say, don't get angry. Remember you did everything you did for yourself and for others. Don't let the anger take you someplace. And one of the men who wrote a Penn Award writing wrote about the announcement in Maryland about the effect that it had when the governor said, I'm no longer going to let anybody out of prison who has a violent crime. He said, the announcement of this policy has drained the state's prison culture of a crucial, if yet intangible, element, its sense of hope. There are paradoxes that I want to describe in this policy of denials of letting people out who pose no public risk, who have transformed themselves, and of serving others. There are three paradoxes. One, the recidivism rates of this group of people, the people who have been convicted of deaths, is the lowest of all crimes. Aging prisoners are not coming back to prison. Long-termers almost never come back. In California, 3% of those convicted of murder return, even though it's not usually for violent crimes, compared to a 77% recidivism rate overall that includes parole revocations and new commitments. In New York State, 1.1% of people convicted of murder come back for a new commitment. 6% if you combine it with parole revocations. The overall return rate is 40% in New York State. 30% for parole revocation and 10% for new convictions. So people who have done this long time, the statistical data shows, even though you have to assess each individual, the recidivism rate is close, is as close to zero as you can get. It's interesting, before these statistics were known and published, a group of women at Bedford Hills asked the visiting chairman of parole some years ago, could he say something, does he know how many women have come back after 15 years of being doing time? And he said no, and they said nobody has come back. He said, well, I don't really know if that's true. He said, I'll go look it up. So he looked it up and he came back and met with the women at Bedford and he said, you're right. No woman that did 15 years in prison has ever come back. And yet the women are continually turned down at the parole board. Paradox number one. Paradox number two, the transformation. The people who do long time are the people who have figured out a way in that time period to give meaning into their lives. Anybody that runs a prison, you ask any superintendent, they'll all say it's the long-termers that facilitate the groups, that are the teachers, that are the mentors, that are the counselors. Some people have said to me, well, maybe they get turned down because they help run the prison. But it's not really why they get turned down. They're turned down because of the overall policy that has said that if you commit a violent crime, you can't really change. And then there's a third paradox. The third paradox is that more punishment doesn't actually lead to more accountability. It doesn't lead to more responsibility. The typical experience of somebody who's been convicted of a violent crime, and for those of you that are lawyers, I think this will make particular sense. They have a lawyer who helps them figure out, how do we minimize what you did? And that's how you're going to get the best deal in a plea or even the narrative that's presented at the trial. How do we minimize it? So let's say you're part of a robbery and someone is killed. And maybe you're the person that was a lookout. So your lawyer will say, well, you're not really, really responsible. You didn't shoot the gun. And that's going to be the argument in terms of the district attorney. And it'll be the argument in front of the judge. Or maybe you did shoot the gun, and the lawyer will say, well, he was in, there was a tussle, and he didn't mean to shoot anybody, or she didn't mean to shoot anybody. I mean, it wasn't intentional. The gun went off, but it wasn't something they meant to do. Well, then you get your 20-year sentence, and you're 19 years old, and you're looking ahead, and you are, like, amazed. You can't believe it. And you've entered prison with a narrative that minimizes your responsibility. And that's also useful for you because it also, nobody wants to be responsible for having killed somebody. People may boast about it at some situations, but by and large, people don't feel good about it. So you have a narrative that minimizes your responsibility and also that makes you feel somewhat better in terms of your conscience. And yet you got this long sentence. And so you experience yourself now, yourself as a victim of a criminal justice system that just didn't understand your age and what happened to you and who you were and why this happened, because it was all basically irrelevant. And so you begin to do your time, and at some point you'll stop rebelling, and you'll take advantage of the programs, and then you turn 40. It's hard to believe, but the 20 years went by. And you go to the parole board, and you're like, you want them to see you for who you are now, just like Philip did in his writing. They want you to talk about the crime. And so when they ask you what happened, because you haven't talked for 20 years about what you did, because it's not what the system of punishment asks for, you go to say, well, the gun went off. And the parole board says, well, who shot the gun? And if you haven't actually come to terms with what you've done, of the damage you've done, of the hurt that you caused, you're not going to be able to say in that parole meeting, I shot the gun, because it's very difficult to say it. People don't want to say it. They also feel if they say it, they're going to be countering what was said at the trial or what was said in the plea bargain. And so the parole board will say, we'll see you in 2 years. And then you really feel like you're a victim. You feel like you did your 20 years, your record is excellent, and yet you can't go home. In fact, the endless punishment that affects people that have done long sentences tends to create a new class of victims. The people who are in the prison who feel that they can't get out. And although I don't want to refer to superintendents as victims, in a sense, they're the ones that have to manage the prison. Because being turned down at a parole board doesn't just affect the person who's turned down. First of all, it affects their family. It affects their children. It affects the people that are waiting for them to come home, who expect after 20 years and the person in prison has done well that they'll come home. But it affects the prison itself. It affects the morale, because if the very people who are in the prison who are doing the best and who in fact are the inspiration to other people to make it through and to do positive things instead of negative things, if those people are turned down, it feels like there's no hope for you 10 years from now to imagine getting out. And so the morale drops in the prison itself, and management of the prison becomes more difficult. Those are the three paradoxes. Those are the three paradoxes that I wanted to talk about before we move into a different model. The paradox that the endless punishment expressed in parole denials is not based in public risk, it's not based in notions of rehabilitation or transformation, and it's not based on the notion of accountability. None of those things happen with this kind of punishment. The central concept that is missing in these parole denials is that of a belief in redemption, of transformation, of valuing people. The issue of solely believing in punishment, because if the value of transformation and public service were there, Sue and Samuel would not have faced between them almost 30 years in prison beyond the time that the judge sentenced them as the minimum amount. The emphasis on punishment misses the extraordinary power that comes from people who have been through the fire of damage done to them, of damage they did to others, of climbing out of that hole and trying to create a new life for themselves, a better world for themselves and their children and for others around them, that I have witnessed over and over again. People in prison, until recently described as inmates, are now officially described by New York State Department of Correctional and Community Services as offenders. So you will be referred to as offender John, or as offender Jane, or offender 92836 with a number. You're frozen in the crime. You're frozen in what you did. Yet people in prison are so often driven to change their lives that they are filled with ideas and energy. People in prison can be agents of their own change, and they can tackle social problems. They can inspire others to change. prisons are unfortunately not the best place for this to happen, and yet it can happen. It can depend on the particular administration. It can depend on a moment in time. It can depend on people themselves figuring out how to do this. I want to speak now of three models in which the alternative approach of seeing people not as defined by their crime, but as defined as people, have taken place and what can come from it. The first is a model of people inside prison and what they can actually do to make change. I was lucky to be in a place at Bedford Hills Correctional Facility where we had this opportunity a number of times. I'm going to talk specifically about the question of college and higher education because it so relates to the issue of transformation, and it's an important issue to think about now. College is a door through which people walk through in prison. It allowed them to find for themselves a different life, a different person, a way to come home and imagine that they could build a different life for themselves and their family. Higher education existed in prisons from the early 1970s until 1994, when the Omnibus Crime Bill that put more time on people staying in prison eliminated the federal government's support for higher education in prison, which was the Pell Grants. When the college program came down inside of Bedford Hills, I have to say that there were tears. It seemed as if a roof had come down on people and that there was no exit. Books were packed, computers were packed up, word processors, since you don't have internet in prison. And people went back to spending their nights playing cards and dominoes, and instead of having books and going down on a program line to college, people would end up getting into fights. But actually, there were people who felt like, maybe we can do something about this and bring college back, even with private funding. And so a process began, working with the administration and working with people on the outside who wanted to help, and it could never have been done without people on the outside. And a large group of people gathered to figure out, how do we bring college back with private funding? And the president of Marymount College at that time said, well, maybe if Marymount issues the bachelor's and associate degree, other colleges could give one professor per semester to teach the necessary course, and it would be a consortium. And so the process began of her bringing college presidents in and meeting with women in green denim shirts and green Devon pants who said, this is why we need college. And one college president after another signed on. And then a survey was done of the women, and hundreds of women said they wanted to go to college. And then the first class that was taught by CUNY grad students in qualitative research at the very beginning involved the 30 students in the class to interviewing other women in the prison as a qualitative study about what is education been like in your life? Did you go to school? Would it be important for you to go to college? Until you had a prison of women that was actually mobilized in this process of trying to create a new college program. When the Learning Center was set up and community volunteers brought in books and word processors and women became tutors, and you had suddenly the ethos of each one teach one, as people in their living units were spending time helping each other learn, catching up on tests, preparing for the remedial tests for those that couldn't go directly into college. College came back, and it came back because of the initiative and the mobilization of the women in prison that were driven for themselves to grow and transform, and they were driven to help others. And that college then became an inspiration to the men at Sing Sing who built another college program, and now you have privately funded in New York State numerous college programs. And those same women have come home and committed themselves to trying to get college back in prisons with government support. So you can see that there's a transformation of individuals that took place in the prison and then stretches and comes home again. I can give many examples of this that show that people in prison can take the initiative, people with violent crimes. And in many cases, this project was led by people who, in fact, had the longest sentences. Model number two. The issue of accountability. How are we accountable when someone is killed? How does that happen? You know, I'm one of those people. I was involved in a crime in which three people were killed. And in many ways, the same process that I described that happened of going through prison and having a narrative that makes you feel better about yourself, I too had a narrative like that. I too was involved in a context, in a situation in which I could distance myself from the actual responsibility of killing somebody. And I could even have a motivation as to why I was involved that day. A friend of mine visited me at some point, many years after I was in prison, and she said, you know, Kathy, she worked in victim services in another state. And she said, you know, Kathy, you make causes of other things. Why not make a cause victims of crime? You know, this is a situation in which it's a cause in which you're directly related to this. I heard her. I thought about it. And then I was in a writing group in which people were writing about the things that had brought them to prison. And one of the women in the group wrote about having actually killed somebody, what she did. She was somebody with extreme mental health problems and drug problems, and she had been off of her mental medication. And I thought about how she actually took full responsibility for what she had done, and she said it to a group of people. And some nights later, I had a dream. I dreamt that I was on a horse. And in the dream, I had a gun, and the gun went off. And I remember worrying, was I responsible for that? Or was the lurch of the horse responsible for that? I was struggling with what responsibility means and what accountability means. Sometime after that, I had the opportunity to actually meet one of the people who witnessed the shooting when I was arrested. I was able to listen to her story about what that day had done to her life. And I went through my own process of writing letters of apology that I knew wouldn't get delivered, but that I wanted to write and to be able to say, I'm sorry, and I know I am responsible. So some of us developed a program that we felt didn't exist any place in the prison system that would create a safe space for people in prison to be able to go through a process of looking at accountability. But it started with the whole person. It started by asking, what's your life history? What's your narrative? How do you describe what happened that took you there that day? What was going on in your life? What are choices that you made? Was there a possibility of different choices? Or did it feel like you had no choices? What are the social factors that created the situation that led you to be there that day? What were the family dynamics? How does that all get integrated? And by the time the person was able to get to talk about what happened that day, because that's very much part of what our program is, the person felt like in the group that she was in, or the individual counselor that she was talking to, she was a whole person. And it made it a lot easier when you're defined not by just what you've done, but by you as a whole person, to be able to say, well, I did do this, or I see it differently now. And it makes it possible to think about, well, what was the damage done? What was the suffering I caused? What could I do about it? And the program that we have that's run by the Osborne Association, the long-termers program, actually takes people through a process where they try to imagine, well, what could they give back? Is there a possibility of repair when somebody's died? And then what could I do in society if I could devise a program that would make a difference? What would that program be to prevent other people from having to get into this situation? Is it accountability? Is it responsibility? The same person that told me many, many years ago, Kathy, you should take up the cause of victims, she said to me the other day, you know, many people who are victims, they just want the person to say, I'm responsible and I feel terrible. Of course, you can't bring back things sometimes, but just to say that. It's not about endless punishment. It's about figuring out, how do we understand this? How do we understand why violence happens? Violence, we know, is terrible. And violence is something which, how can I say it? We want to, in a way, many people that are involved in sort of the mass incarceration movement are very aware of how many people have come to prison for nonviolent crimes. We actually have to understand that people are also in prison for violent crimes. 50% of the people in state prisons are there for violent crimes. And in fact, the communities that suffer the most from the violence are their communities. What do we do about it? I want to share some of the things that we learned from the program that we've been doing. First, the overwhelming majority of men and women were people who themselves were victims of violence. The majority of men and women in prison for violent crimes were victims themselves of violence in their own lives. The context they grew up in, the choices. Victim services organizations that now exist to be able to reach out to victims could very well reach out to people that are in prison. They too need help. from their lives and what happened to them. The line between victim and perpetrator is frequently blurred. That's one thing that we learned. Another thing we learned is that the punishment model only creates a class of new victims, of people who are not seen as whole human beings and are angry about that and feel sad about that. That there's no place in prison in our justice system which is solely based on punishment, in which people can actually talk about the crime and yet not be defined and frozen in it. And finally, that there's a tremendous fear in the social justice community for thinking about individual responsibility. And it's reasonable because individual responsibility is placed on people who have committed crime instead of being able to integrate social responsibility and individual responsibility. But if we're going to overcome the bifurcation that exists between the victims' rights movement and the prisoners' rights movement and the social justice movement, we have to understand the harm that was done. And we also have to ask the question why and not reduce the people to being forever a criminal. Violence is something that all of us have thought of following the Newtown experience. And yet, what's the solution to it? There's many solutions that have been put out there. For one thing, the solution is not found in more punishment and more guns. There are some people that may need to be in prison because they're dangerous, but likelihood is that they may not need to be in prison. They may be much better served if they're in a mental health institution. Most people don't need to be there, and they don't need to be there for the long sentences that they are, because people do change. Finally, I want to look at the model of people coming home. Right? We've looked at two models that are different from a punishment model inside. Let's look at the model for people coming home. People coming back to society have enormous, enormous struggle after 15, 20, 25 years. Some of it's the technology, but some of it is just the orientation. You know, somebody spoke the other day about the fact that she couldn't look at a streetlight and actually know when she should cross and when she shouldn't. Was the hand that was up there, what was it saying? What was the color? I know when I came home, I was like so excited about umbrellas. I had been using a garbage bag over my head for 20 years in prison just to walk. And then to use an umbrella and I stepped out the first day, I was like, wow, this is actually keeping me out of the rain. But then when I got to a subway, I didn't know, well, when was I supposed to put the umbrella down? You put it down when you're in or when you're before you go in and then you get wet. I mean, you're like studying wherever you are, you're studying because it's like being in another country and you can't quite talk that language. So coming home is difficult no matter what. And it's difficult to come home when there's a recession and you're looking for a job. And you're somebody that has to check a box that says, felon, yes. Or you're applying for housing, private housing, and they ask you, do you have a felon? And you say yes. So all of these things follow you. But it's even harder because there's a whole system called collateral punishments that were passed in the middle of the 1990s and have become part of our culture that continue the punishment of people that have come home from prison. In the 1990s, the law was passed that said you couldn't get welfare or food stamps. You can't live in public housing if you have a drug crime. You can't vote in many states until you're off parole. All of these punishments are, you can't apply for college. Most colleges on the application will say, do you have a felony? And then they'll want to know what the felony was. So all of these things come back against people. And it's hard to survive. And then there's the stigma and the shame that's reinforced over and over again by these kinds of laws, this kind of punishment that continues and continues and continues. Even the official state language now is when you come home, you're an ex-offender. So when you go into your parole office, you're an ex-offender. It's like, when do you ever get out of that definition of self? It doesn't help. But I'm part of a community of people who have come home from prison, people who are doing enormously important work. Sometimes we refer to each other as returning citizens instead of ex-offenders. Or we say that we're coming home. Some of us are people that did long time and some short time. People that I know who have come home from prison, they're directing programs in a clinic for people, other people coming home. They're working at Rikers Island. They're initiating programs to bring the aging home. They're leading the struggle to get the Pell Grants reinstated. They're providing services for people to get housing. And you may think that I'm describing only the few who got these degrees that make it possible for to do this. But actually, there's a relationship between those people and the other people coming home that don't have their master's degrees in social work. And the relationship is one of support. The same community that existed in prison is being built out here. And the people who, in fact, are working in all of these programs and the organizations that hire them on their staff, those same people are serving other people coming home and are able to say, I walked in your shoes. I understand you, and it's hard. And let's talk about what it would be like now to get your GED or to get an education. This is a different model. It's looking at the people coming home from prison not as a liability or as a threat, but instead as a tremendous resource. This is a paradigm, and it's a paradigm that instead builds on the strengths of people rather than defining them by their weaknesses. It's a tremendous resource for our society. The truth is that change is happening in the criminal justice system. I've presented a fairly bleak picture, and I think it is bleak still, but it's also true that change is happening. Some indications, 40% decrease of the number of juveniles held now in prison. Some heightening of the parole release. The new governor of California, even though he's not releasing a lot of people, at least 80% now of the people that are recommended to him by the parole board, he is releasing. Even in New York State, the numbers of people being released who are going to their first parole board who are long-termers is slowly climbing. There's a greater number of colleges that now exist in prison, even if they're privately funded. And pilot projects are being built to see about bringing in government funding. While we can attribute some of these changes to economic reasons, and I don't want to downplay the importance of economic change, they're also coming because of the force of people that are inserting the importance of humanity. In some ways, I've thought about the civil rights movement, and I've thought about the fact that, you know, it was certainly true that the Civil War took place and slavery was ended in that context for a lot of different reasons. You know, one of which was to preserve the Union with the North in a dominant role so that the economy could develop along the line so that industrialization could take place. There are political and economic reasons of that sort that led to the end of slavery. But at the same time, there was the voice of the abolitionists, and those abolitionists inserted the voice of humanity. And I think that that's true now. It's not just the economic reasons that are leading to the closing of prisons. And those people, all of you here that are doing this work, that know people are doing this work, it's critical to keep humanity in the center, that the prison system that's been created is inhumane, and there is an alternative way of dealing with people who end up needing to have help or needing to be punished, and it's not about an endless punishment. This change that we see happening is part happening. We can see it happening partly because a system is being named, right? The system that underlies mass incarceration, there's a way of, I know that naming a system is helpful because it ties together a lot of individual things and a lot of individual problems. Certainly the structural racial and economic system, which leads to such inequality and communities that have no resources, is a critical piece of the system that we now have. So to name that system and to understand that underlies the concept of prison abolition is based on being able to name a system that's rooted in racial and class inequality that's only getting worse. The new Jim Crow, a system that's based on racial casting, once again recreating a kind of Jim Crow system so that when people come home from prison, they carry with them the punishments that don't end. A public health system. Can we look at the issue of people in prison instead of as criminals or criminalization, as people with public health problems? All the people in prison with mental health problems, all the people in prison that have drug problems. Prison could, we could look at an alternative model, public health. or education instead of incarceration, understanding the link between the educational system and the failures of that system and the school-to-prison pipeline and zero tolerance, education instead of incarceration. The systems have been named, people have written about it, and that's important. And then there are the campaigns that are happening to make change, and they have made a tremendous difference. Solitary confinement. Finally, it's up in front of the UN as a form of torture and in front of Congress as a violation of the Eighth Amendment of cruel and unusual punishment. The limits of education. Let's restore the Pell Grants and give people that education. Campaign to end the boxes that you have to check off so that before you even get to have an interview, you're eliminated from the possible pool of people to be employed. Right? Felony disenfranchisement. Let people vote. Accept people when they come home as citizens. These are all campaigns. So we have analysis, we have campaigns, there's motion happening, and there is change happening. And I think that many people who are formerly incarcerated, people who have come home, are playing a critical role with others of you that are doing that work, and it's a collaboration. Let's remember the language that we use. Let's remember the people that are in prison are not the act that brought them there. And let's look at the hard questions and face them, because we will be able to find alternative answers than permanent punishment. In the 1960s, I moved to Cleveland, Ohio, and was part of the civil rights movement and the welfare rights movement. I lived and worked with people who were considered the throwaway people, characterized in the newspapers as lazy and as cheats. I understood, after being there for 2 years and 3 years, maybe it only took 6 months. I understood the opportunities that I had had that they hadn't had. And I also understood the challenges they faced, the challenges to feed their families, the challenges to simply get their child to the hospital and into the emergency ward when they didn't have a car and or know how to drive. And I understood the resources and the strength that they had when they could become part of a movement that respected them and understood them, and their insight could play a role in thinking of solutions. We have to nurture the human spirit and not crush it. Here, before this lecture, I met with a group of students. There was tremendous idealism. There was tremendous hope that they could make a difference in changing the system. This is the energy that needs to be nourished. This is the energy that I felt in prison and I feel in the community that I'm part of since I've come home, that includes people who are incarcerated, as well as many of you here who have been part of that. There's no time like the present. Thank you.
I feel like we've all been blessed to be here today. That was just an extraordinary talk and the product of an extraordinary life. We'll put it up on the Sheinberg website, the video, because there are lots of people who were not blessed to be here today. And Kathy, it's going to go viral. That was a fabulous talk. We have some time for questions. There are mics there. Do we only have one mic? Two mics. Anyone has questions? Go to the mic and ask them. Well, we're waiting for, there's somebody at the mic. But I will also announce that first-year students who would like to be part of this wonderful process, applications are due on Friday. And there's a little form in the back. It's a simple application. A form in the back that gives you all the details. Go ahead.
Okay. Yeah.
Hi, Kathy.
Hi.
I'm Jane Truhold, and first of all, thank you. That was just brilliant, your exposition of what was and possibly hope for the future. along with all the work that you do. I'm wondering what you... I'm a lawyer who does represent a long-termer who's up for parole. And I'm wondering what, in your experience, what has made the difference for those who are released and those who aren't released on their...
I think the biggest difference has to do with what parole commissioner sits in front of you. I mean, it's hard to say that because it's unfortunate, but it is true. In terms of whether or not you can have any impact yourself on it, I think one is believing in yourself makes a difference. I think being able to talk about what you actually have done and being able to figure out how you define your responsibility for it can make a difference. I think people's responsibility varies, but I think being able to figure that out before you go and not simply talk about who you are now is important. Whether it's the system that we want to have is another question. But I think that in this period, being able to do that actually makes a difference. But it may not be decisive, because in the end, it's going to be the values and the views of the commissioners that's in front of you that's going to make that difference.
I have just two short questions. One is whether, in your experience or those of your colleagues, the certificates of relief have been any help at all in reentry? And the second question is whether this determinant sentencing structure in New York State, even though it's for B violence and below, even though it's long, it does do away to a great extent with parole discretion in getting parole or getting out of your state prison. Is that any help at all in the way you see the system?
You know, if you ask people in prison, would they rather have what's called determinant sentencing, where the judge gives you a flat sentence and you know when you're going to get out, versus having to go to a parole board, people would probably feel a little split about it, because the determinant sentencings are always ending up being longer than the minimum sentence that the judge could have given you. So I think that the issue of certainty but greater length versus uncertainty is a hard question to answer, and I think it's hard to answer that in the abstract. So I think it's an important question. I actually predicted that somebody would ask me that question, and the answer is I think people vary on it. People want certainty, and yet they don't want the additional years that the long sentence gives. And I think there is some sense that they feel as if when they do something in prison, that going to parole will recognize that change and transformation in what they've done, and yet in this last period, it mainly hasn't made much difference. In terms of certificates of relief, I think one of the things is that it can make a difference, but it can take a long time to get one. It can take time to get one. You have to go through a process. So I'm not probably, I can't answer that question more specifically than that.
Hi, Kathy.
Hi, Serena.
It's my first time being back in the city since having my son, and I came for you.
Thank you.
and I think there's a reason I'm wearing blue and black today.
Yes. That's good.
on a serious note, it's been so moving to hear Chaza talking about you as a mother. And it's for me, I think about what will my son think of me? And I hope it will be something similar. So thank you. And for people,
I'm glad that he'll be able to relate to you directly.
Also. Yes. And I'm a program director for a writing workshop for women in prison on Long Island, in jail. I'm formerly incarcerated. And I remember going out and walking laps with you and having strategy discussions about how to get our poetry writing class moving in Bedford and all of these wonderful things. And so it's just wonderful and amazing, and I owe you so much. Thank you.
I'm so glad you're here.
Thank you. Thank you.
And Who are the people who continue these parole decisions accountable to? How are they selected? Who judges how good a job they're doing? What rules are they following?
The parole commissioners are appointed solely by the governor. He gets recommendations for people from various people that are, I would say, elected officials, as well as people that are in different institutions. I mean, when Governor Spitzer was governor, he actually appointed four people that were in the Attorney General's office, as well as one person from the Brooklyn DA's office. The majority of people that are appointed are law enforcement. Some people come from probation, some people may come from counseling, but they are overwhelmingly, they're overwhelmingly rewards for things that people have done and are recognized. This is a six-year term. I think that the policy of the governor plays a very important role, both in who they select as well as sort of the decisions they make. But individual commissioners do make their own decisions, and there are very strong differences that take place amongst them. There's no oversight, and there's no review board for who actually gets the position of it. It needs to be changed. Clearly, the people that are on the parole board should have many more people on the parole board that come from the community, people from the parole board that actually respect the notions of change and transformation. And I think that that would make a difference. And I think there should be some oversight. And there are people that are tracking the rates of decision making that are made. Although it's hard to do it because people get their parole decision, it's hard to get every decision and every commissioner's decision. But there's a general knowledge that there's some people who are commissioners that will never let somebody go who has been convicted of a murder. They just won't let them go. It doesn't matter what they've done. It doesn't matter what anybody else thinks. They're not going to let them go. There's other people that will never let somebody go, and with the person that has been hurt or killed is a police officer. They will never let them go. I think that the Police Benevolent Association actually plays a major role in terms of weighing in about whether somebody's going to get released or not, and that plays an important role, and is done both through the media as well as done through how they work with the victim impact statements that are made.
While you're on a more policy, I wondered if you had anything to say about the private prison and the whole private prison complex that we now have and how that plays into whether or not we can afford empty beds anymore and who's lobbying for filling these prisons that we keep building.
I mean, the private prisons were a combination of what some people have referred to as the prison industrial complex. It was a way to turn the issue of punishment into something that would be profitable to people. And I think most of you have probably heard about the judge that, or number of judges that have sentenced youth to juvenile prisons and got kickbacks from the private, for the prisons that, the private people that ran those prisons. And I think that when you start having punishment for profit, you're really in trouble in terms of the quality of what's going to happen. I think that, private prisons are particularly a problem now in the immigration field, but also they are an issue. And certainly, if you're trying to just simply limit costs, you know, I think that we know, for those of you that, you know, this is the 150th anniversary of the Emancipation Proclamation. And the 13th Amendment is great because it eliminates slavery. It's a really important thing, and I'm sure many of you have seen the movie Lincoln. But if you read the 13th Amendment carefully, you'll notice that slavery is still allowed for people that have been duly convicted of a crime. So that's important to note, that it's both whether you're in prison or not in prison, slavery is still considered legal. So private prisons will play into that. Okay.
Yeah. To what degree does the nature of the particular prison superintendent determine the experience of the prisoners?
I would say that prisons are in many ways are like little fiefdoms or fiefdoms, and that the particular experience within a prison depends a tremendous amount on the particular person that's the warden of that prison or the superintendent of that prison. The prison that I was at had a superintendent that was there for 20 years, which is a very long time, and she did actually believe that women in prison could be more than the crime that they were sentenced to. you know, there's no question that that having a warden means you have really almost total power over the people there, and there's no prison that's good to be in, but there are real differences. The person that's now Commissioner of Corrections was the warden at Sing Sing, and he supported tremendously things such as the Theater of the Arts, which was having theatrical and plays there that people could be in, supported the college program there. So I think that it makes a tremendous difference what the particular warden is. And you know, some wardens or superintendents come up through what's called a security track. They may have been the security, deputy security of a given prison, and others come up through a program track. And that will make a big difference as to how the prison is run.
Hi. First, I want to thank you very much for your very powerful presentation. Now, speaking of punishment for profit, from a totally different perspective, I heard many stories of people committing crimes just to get into the federal prison and to get free medical care. How do you feel about that?
You know, I want to say something that maybe is a short answer to that. I have heard people come home from prison, or I have heard people that I was in prison with say, prison saved me. And when you hear their life story, they were for the first time able to get away from abuse, able to get away from drugs, and they were able to actually complete their GED program, and they were able to actually go to college. And so what I say is, what a sad society to think that prison is the way that we have to save people.